There we go. Okay, so real quick as intro, thank you everyone that has already joined. We will just do a quick intro on Expert Lead in case you haven't heard of us, so let you know why pretty much we're hosting this webinar. And then I'll leave the stage to Mirela, who will be giving us really interesting facts on how to work more effectively with product managers. So really looking forward to it. So really quick about us, in case you haven't heard about us, Expert Lead is pretty much a community of freelancers. So the company was founded in 2018. We're located in Berlin. However, we currently have freelancers from all over Europe and overseas. Our network currently comprises over 1,000 freelancers, from developers, data scientists, UX, UI designers, product and project managers, and cybersecurity, also both for web and mobile. So we're currently building this community. The idea is not just to go into the agency model of pure matching, but we actually want to build a community where we get to know you as freelancers. We have dedicated freelancer managers for each group. We want to hear about your preferences, want to hear about your passion, what actually makes it interesting for you in a project, while of course you keep the freedom of choosing yourselves, getting all the information, choosing your rate, pretty much everything that makes freelancing what it is. We just want to be there for you, help you, share also some soft skills and knowledge among, like, from us, but also enable knowledge sharing among yourselves. This is actually why Mirela is here. So this is pretty much the reasoning behind Expert Lead. Real quick about our clients. So here you can see just a few brandings that we're currently working with. So we work with clients from advertising and media to retail, consumers, education, training, manufacturing. So really wide entities and industries. We also work both with bigger companies and startups. So we like to keep it varied, trying to find everything, anything that actually fits everybody's preferences. About how it actually works at Expert Lead, real quick. So as I said, we have this personality screening where freelancer managers get to know freelancers, get to know not only their skills, but actually their career, desired career path, their preferences, what they're looking for, what their passions are. Then depending on which group they would like to belong to, we even have this case that I'm showing right now, which is which starts with some coding challenge, pretty much just to get to know the coding style, get to know some basics, and then the peer-to-peer review, which is actually the other next step for product managers and project managers within Expert Lead. This peer-to-peer interview is actually a review from a more technical perspective on what your skills are, what tools you're normally using, what your experience is about, not only to hear the HR side of it, but actually to have a direct contact with another colleague. And to the extent possible, we also have this peer-to-peers with other freelancers also in the network. So you have the opportunity to talk to a colleague already part of a community and hear it firsthand what it's actually all about and what Expert Lead is about. So as I said, PMPO testing is a little bit shorter without the coding challenge, but yet we want to hear it from you, really from a technical perspective, what you enjoy doing, what's your passion, and then you would be part of our community with a dedicated freelancer manager that will be there for you. The idea is that we're there for you. We hear your preferences, as I said, availability, desires. We just try to do our best to make your life easier as a freelancer and give you that sense of belonging that sometimes it's really nice to have in a way. So that really brief about Expert Lead. Mirela, if you want to take the stage, I'll just stop sharing and you can take over.
Thank you so much. Let me go into presentation mode here and then share screen. All right, and I'm assuming you see it?
Yes.
Perfect. So welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming here to attend the talk. This is a summary of things I've noticed working for me when onboarding at various clients during my work as a consultant or contractor on projects that vary between 1 and 12 months, with a sweet spot around 3 to 6 for most of them. So this is an outline of the talk, quick intro about myself. What do we consider onboarding as a quick definition? Why is it really hard for a PM? And then what would be an ideal and a real scenario for this? So I've been in product management for about 8 years. Started initially for a startup in Silicon Valley, working out of their Bucharest office. Then later on, I moved into product leadership, had about 2 roles of this before going into what I would call product consulting. Some people call it freelancing. It's kind of the same. You go in and help a company temporarily, doing the same thing a regular PM would do, or on if it's a less hands-on work, helping with structuring the product department or some topics of that department. And my background is in computer science. I also did an MBA later on, and I'm the founder of Product People, which is a product management consultancy and community builder. You might know us from the talks that we organize in Berlin with various product leaders coming from Reddit, Facebook, or also local companies like N26 or from Europe, Spotify. And so these are a few of the clients that we served. I focused a bit more on the B2C ones because the B2B ones people don't know about, even if they're billion-dollar companies. So our approach to logos mirrors this. And now going to the gist of the talk on onboarding. So the Wikipedia definition would be the mechanism through which a new employee acquires the knowledge, skills, and behavior in order to become effective. Oh, and I lost focus on this. I got this from a book called The First 90 Days by Michael Watkins. It's quite an interesting book, especially if you're switching companies or if you've switched bosses or if there's anything regarding a new context, because it teaches you how to map your stakeholders, how to manage up, how to manage laterally, and what kind of things to take on to prove yourself in the initial phase of a new project or a company restructuring or just getting into a new department or boss setup. And the way a company looks at this is, what is the break-even point from the moment the person we have invested some time into onboarding has produced enough value to counterbalance the time we and resources we've invested in them getting up to speed. And for a regular employee, the break-even point is at 6 months. They're considered that in the first 3 months, the new hire is just consuming value, and only after that mark they are starting to produce value for the organization. And that would be the summary. So you can consider you have stopped onboarding in a new department or a new company or project when you've already delivered some value that you can find tangible or that you can measure in a meaningful way. And that's, of course, very hard to measure it, because for a product manager, it's hard for people to agree on usual what does a product manager do, and then measuring the value of what they do is even a bit harder, and there's not a very great consensus about it. But my take on it would be on the outcomes you've helped drive. So did you move any business metrics? Or improved in a measurable way the user experience, net promoter score, or any of these usually measured things. And at the same time, have you done this without making everyone angry at you, or at least keeping the spirits at the same level. So the stakeholder and team happiness is also important for continuing to still be working with them. And the other part, to prove that this the things that you've done are repeatable, did you set up a process or did you follow some methods that show that this didn't just happen by accident, but it's a controllable set of outcomes you can produce? And most importantly, how fast did you make the impact above on outcomes and processes? So that is also different on organization. I've had a very interesting talk with people from very functioning companies. And I've also noticed that for the clients who have a great working business model, great team culture, they're more established as a company, it's harder to produce outcomes. Whereas if things are falling apart, I felt I could produce outcomes in the first days, or help with some fire that was burning or some super obvious thing that was missing and was not there in place, and I could bring some knowledge from the outside to do it. And the reason why a successful organization is difficult is that you first need to learn what made them successful and what things you should not break or mess around with before you go in and make the changes to make their success even greater. So one of the ways of looking at it, if you land into a successful organization, the outcomes you can produce initially will not be the result of your work, but will be more the follow-up of a good strategy or decisions the people that brought you in had, because they have lined up some things for you. And then you can prove you are still helpful by not needing to handholding, by learning their processes very fast and just continuing to deliver these things that were set out for you initially, while you learn more about the company and can create your own initiatives and other and maybe potentially influence even some processes, which is even harder in a functioning organization because you need to better understand it to see if some friction there is a result of something bad happening and they had to introduce that checkpoint, or is it actually a flawed process? And the disaster part I've already covered, and everyone can recognize that. And especially if it's a leadership void, just by stepping in and saying, hey, I'm in charge of X, then you get 20 people coming to you, or like a lot of Slack messages or emails, like forwarding all their problems they've had on that topic and haven't been answered or have been rejected by the previous person. So that in that type of company, you get started very fast and can make a measurable impact. Okay, so now that we've defined what is onboarding and how does it differ from a successful company and one that is less successful or functional, or we can also check on why is it hard. So for people who have various opinions on product management, I would define that the PM, sometimes they're called product owner when it's more of a scrum function, you're in charge of delivering certain value to the organization. And that organization can, that value can be either growing revenue or users or different metrics that or helping the company pursue that strategy they have set to pursue for that certain year or quarter. And you do that by working not only with the tech team. A lot of times when we talk about PMs, it's a big focus on how do you groom your user stories and how do you do these estimates? But you also invest other people's times. You work with legal, you work with sales, with product marketing, with customer care, and your work also affects their work, because if you do something that raises more touch points, then you need to also deal with that. So it's not only about tech. My view on PM is the connecting tissue that needs to make some business goals happen, regardless of who they get their help from inside the organization. So that's the first point. We have a very high surface area. Some people understand their surface area to be limited to just tech and just like passing some notes from here to there. But if you do it right, you interact with everyone that you need to interact with for the topic that you are in charge of. And then by interacting with them or giving them tasks or asking them for support, then you also invest their time. So you are taking a lot of value out of the organization that you're focusing on your certain initiative. And at the same time, you make or break the information flow, because if something gets lost in translation or doesn't end up where it should, it can be very bad in some cases. And the fourth point I've added after talking with some people who are in fintech, and for them, it's very important that the PMs have this domain knowledge due to data protection or regulatory things that can get the company shut down or incur heavily fines. So for them, the domain knowledge is also very important when onboarding someone. In other cases, if it's an e-commerce play or something that's less regulated, the domain knowledge can also follow your initial onboarding on things or when you go deeper into certain areas. And the last but definitely not least, understanding the strategic context. So this is, I touched upon before talking with point number one. That is more what is the company trying to do now, next, and a bit later. And then focusing all our initiatives into supporting that and not going on some side quest. And of course, for as I run a business, so my ideal scenario, as I understand it for someone who has founded a company, is that every person we bring in has delivered value even before they join, right? So there's no buyer's remorse in any situation. And we've tried to be like that also for our customers. As I know this from being a business owner myself. But it's, of course, very hard and very unlikely because you don't know everything that they had tried before. And I've also learned when before joining a client's organization, when I would appraise their product as an external person, I would be like, why don't they do X? X is so obvious. And then I would go there and I see that there was this A-B test 6 months ago and it had failed, didn't produce any significant results. So they've already tried and shelved that. And I was like, oh, wow, I didn't know that. I would have proposed it if I didn't know it already happened. So the part about delivering value, this is an example that I personally like a lot. It's about, it's called The Founder, about how the initial days of McDonald's, which right now is feeding 1% of the Earth population. But in the scene that you're going to see in the movie is that the person who is expanding the franchise had financial trouble. And his troubles are overheard by Harry Sonnenborn, a consultant, and that he offers to help. And he gets to walk into their office, gets their book, and the founder waits for him to review this. And at the end, he makes this proposal, which I need to switch to desktop and load the movie because otherwise it doesn't work well. Could someone quickly confirm that this works when I started?
For me, it does, but without audio.
Sorry?
For me, it works, but without any sound.
All right, because the sound is, sorry. I forgot how I did this last time.
Minuscule revenue stream. no cash reserves, and an albatross of a company.
Is this better? Okay.
Perfect.
All right, then I will put it because it had the interesting stuff in the beginning.
So to summarize, you have a minuscule revenue stream, no cash reserves, and an albatross of a contract that requires you to go through a slow approval process to enact changes if they're approved at all, which they never are. Am I missing anything?
About sums up.
Tell me about the land.
The land.
The land, the buildings, how that whole aspect of it works.
Oh, pretty simple, really. Franchisee finds a piece of land he likes, gets a lease, usually 20 years, takes out a construction loan, goes up a building, and off he goes.
So the operator selects the site.
Yeah.
He picks the property.
Right.
You provide the training, the system, the operational know-how, and he is responsible for the rest.
Is there a problem?
A big one. You don't seem to realize what business you're in. You're not in the burger business. You're in the real estate business. You don't build an empire off a 1.4% cut of a 15-cent hamburger. You build it by owning the land upon which that burger is cooked. What you ought to be doing is buying up plots of land, then turning around and leasing said plots to franchisees, who, as a condition of their deal, should be permitted to lease from you and you alone. This will provide you with two things. One, a steady upfront revenue stream. Money flows in before the first stake is in the ground. Two, greater capital for expansion, which in turn fuels further land acquisition, which in turn fuels further expansion, and so on, and so on. Land. That's where the money is. And more than that, control. Control over the franchisee. Fail to uphold quality standards, you cancel their lease. Control over Dick and Mac. End result, you'll have the banks and the franchisees in the palm of your hand.
If I were to do this, the brothers, they effectively would be...
Yes. So, what do you say, Ray?
Okay, so I see we have, should we answer the questions now or should I go back to the talk?
As you prefer.
Okay, then since I switched it, just a second. For a product owner, is it easier to be productive from day one by quickly organizing the task or the sprint? One does not need to know everything in the beginning, just a comment. Cool, thank you, Anubhav.
Okay, so this we saw and the punchline of the video that everyone here saw is that I'm not Harry Sonnenberg, but I found some shortcuts that help me deliver value to new clients in 1-2 weeks. And from the comment we just read, this is true. I've also done the part of prioritizing, but it's pretty hard to know if you're prioritizing stuff that doesn't have value, because sometimes, at least for me, I inherit things from the product backlog of 1 or 2 PMs before. And especially when we're brought in, there's some sort of trouble. What I found helps to prioritize technical debt once I know the areas that we would go into. Or if it's a customer-facing application and the top of the funnel has a very slow loading page speed or some critical
five parts of the journey, then this I can prioritize without thinking too much about it, because I know they have an impact just from studies and previous experience. But otherwise, prioritizing some random features in the backlog, that I wouldn't do, because I have no background about them and I don't even know if they're useful. And what if people go into deeper questions or like, how do we test, how do we track this? Then I need to understand how all these tooling and processes work. So this wouldn't be my go-to thing, unless it's for technical depth that I understand the scope of and the value and the areas that it affects. And it would also take less than a week to fix or to have some meaningful traction to show for it, so that people can get some of the tasks closed and then they can focus on things that we found have more business value. So this is the slide where I don't say just take my word for it, but there we have a few LinkedIn references from previous clients that usually say we onboarded super fast. And this, the one with the air team, was from Omio, one of our former clients, where I didn't know anything about air travel and how complex it is before I joined there. So I fell asleep a few nights on Wikipedia articles about how this thing works behind the scene, and how all the oligopolies in this business started and how they've evolved over time, because that influenced a lot of how we showed inventory, who do you took it from, how do we get the prices and the fares and everything. And then the other part was like, we're not just fast, but we also delivered value while keeping the team happy. There are also some people who do that, but they end up burning out the team, which is probably something you don't want when you bring in an external person. All right, and now we go into metaphors. So this is from one of my favorite book series. It's called Culture Series by Ian M. Banks. If you haven't read anything, don't start with this one. Start with A Player of Games. It's about a civilization that has solved all the problems we currently have. So people live almost infinite lifespans if they want to. There's no sickness, no death. There's universal basic income. AIs have the same rights. So most of the things that we see now as problems or limitations have been solved there. They're spanning the whole galaxy, so you can go and live wherever you want and travel wherever you want. And of course they are bored, and now most of the plots in the game is that they encounter civilizations that are less developed than theirs, and they try to set these civilizations on the right path. Which of course some people in these other civilizations don't agree with, because if you were running an authoritarian regime, you wouldn't think that this is a good idea to just give everyone rights and free money and so on. And the culture employs a few agents to try to steer up things in this other civilizations that they interact with. And the quote is from one of these agents that is thrown into a place that is not extremely friendly to them and that they don't know very well, and they are supposed to help it get on the right path. And it sounded exactly like product management and what we do. So what I liked about it is that they have that rules were forged as we went along, and they're never the same twice anyway. Because all these things that you read on the blog post that Agile is done like this and Scrum is like that, and this OKRs should be done like this and like that. And whenever you go into a new organization, then they do it slightly twisted or completely opposite or something. So you have to discover all this process altogether. And that's why I would say, like, some things could not be known or predicted or even judged with any real certainty until you go in there. And I've also had this thing where we talk with clients and they say, we do this and that, and we do it this way. And then you go there and it's nothing like it. It's like you're talking about a different company. But in the end, all of this comes down with people and problems. And this is also a way I structured my approach, as you will see in the following slides. So people and problems. And then for people, this means anyone that you need to interact with, especially initially, or get help from, work from, report to, anything like that. On the second part of being visible, I found a case where that was not helpful, but in all the other clients we've had, except from one, being visible has always worked. On problems, you have the main quest, you have the product context and the company context. And then we will see this in details on the next slides. All right, so people. The first one is pretty easy. This is probably also the expert lead folks could tell you. Usually when consultancies or agencies and so on call the person that brings them in their champion, because this is the person that risks their reputation. And this is the person that if all else fails, you need to deliver results from them. If the company is well aligned, when you deliver results for your champion, you also deliver for the organization or for that business unit. If it's misaligned, then you do your best, but you need to help the champion. Stakeholders, everyone knows this word. So you need to understand who's who and approach the relevant people faster. Usually the champion is the best place to start to get a list of the stakeholders. And then from those stakeholders, you get a list of others if needed. Peers, I would put there more on the line of people you need to get the work done. So in some cases, a stakeholder can also be a peer, but I would see more divide sales marketing into stakeholders and dev design, analysis, analytics, BI into peers. Well, and the troublemaker is also very self-explanatory and unfortunately also found in some places. I'm assuming it's not only for people joining an external organization, you also have that in your company. And I'm curious to learn about it in the Q&A session. Oh, I've hit the time limit. Is my screen, is the slide visible?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So the role is usually the managing director, the founder, the CPO, VP, head of product, but sometimes we've also been brought in by a product manager and helped as a peer. The stakeholders, as I mentioned before, it's I've put them more in the business roles. For peers, yeah, I forgot to, before turning to this slide, product can also be a peer. If it's a larger product organization, then product, user research, all of this other function will also be your peer, as you may do things that you need to align with them on, or it touches part of their journeys or KPIs. So you need their approval or at least input. So things to do for the champion, keep them happy, help them get the desired outcome and get them to look good. So don't go on taking all the credit. They need to take the credit because they brought you in to solve some problems. For the stakeholders, it's probably not telling you something new, figuring out their goals and incentives. So the incentives are the ones who get you into or out of trouble, as well as the constraints, ways of working and communication preferences. So that's pretty simple. Are they email or Slack people? Are they into a lot of Zoom calls? And if yes, how can you minimize that? And so on. And what do you need from them to achieve your main quest? Basically what the champion brought you in to do. Then for peers, the same as above, plus build a good rapport with. And what I like to do in bigger organization is to identify who are the most competent and responsive individual contributors. Because then you can go to them with questions or half-baked ideas that it sometimes takes you too long to dismiss or to refine, or at least initially to just tell you, hey, you should also look there. And that I found super helpful, especially in organizations that have more complex products or a lot of things going on. it's great to find them. And then for the troublemakers, I kind of clustered everyone there that creates unnecessary drama or noise. So that divas, keyboard warriors, some don't create it unnecessarily. They are political opponents of your champion. They are also disgruntled people or people who feel like if someone is coming in and doing more things than they did in the last 3 months, and that person does it in 1-2 weeks, then this is not going to reflect nice on them. So they could also try to sabotage you here and there. So it's usually useful to at least start mapping some of them, and for the ones who are just very vocal, to diffuse them preemptively, or to tell your stakeholders, hey, I'm going to do this, and I know this person or this department will complain if you don't want to like point someone specifically. Let me know if that is a blocker, because otherwise I will still do it. So there are various ways to manage them, and if you can anticipate their attacks. All right, so the visible part, which worked in most cases, almost all cases. So that's why I'm giving it with a grain of salt. And I can detail that if anyone is curious in the Q&A. What I do first thing, get access to all the basic communication tools, do a personal intro to stakeholders and peers. I also intro myself in channels, or if it's a relevant mail group, depending also on the company size, because you don't want to message 400 people, hey, a random new person is here to do a small topic. So if it's some at a bigger client where my topic is within a group of 25 to 50 people, then I just approach this group specifically and ignore everything else. If it's a smaller company and I'm going to interact with half of it, then I can also make an intro, let's say for a 40 to 70 people company, I would also make an intro in the Slack general channel, because that means that I would probably interact with a lot of them. And the third one has been disputed. Some people said that they don't like when others do this. Personally, I do, because whenever I have a meeting with someone, I can quickly check their profile and see if we know people, if we've worked with the same companies, if there's something that we can quickly build a report on. And at the same time, I don't get access to the internal employee or org chart tools. So LinkedIn or Xing are my only source of figuring out who's who and how long have they been around and what kind of things would they know, at least based on their background. Then on the communication, I do the usual things that if you read a blog post that they all kind of say that, get into the flow. So being in the middle of everything initially, even if it's a bit overwhelming, involve people asking for feedback and just be fast to respond, or at least try to point them in the right direction. This is, of course, easier at the companies that kind of reach 500 people, but I've noticed at bigger clients, the right direction is a bit more difficult. So there I try to point them at least towards a department or some other area they could check. Then just taking all the noise and nasty stuff for your team, if issues get escalated. Of course, if it impacts your main quest, so if it's something unrelated, I have also gotten pretty good at ignoring things that are not in my main path. And there's this consultancy saying that don't boil the ocean. Because if you stretch yourself too thin and you get into too many topics that you're not very deep into, you may end up making the wrong decisions there. So it's better to focus on the initial thing you were brought in and then do side quests once that is secure. And of course, with the relevant updates here, I try to over communicate if possible. So if I know like the next level of mailing list includes 100 people instead of 50, I'm still fine to send it on the 100 people list. Just in case someone from somewhere was planning to do something completely contradictory, and they would do it if they don't get this email. And I also try to get the team to sometimes stretch themselves a little bit. So if a dev team is blocked with something, they don't need to wait for my reply. It's like, can you talk with the other team? Or there are some things that you can already do by yourself. If it, of course, not something that impacts or changes the scope completely. And this has worked for people who were very hungry for this. All right, now we finished the people and visibility part. We're going into the problems, which I've used as an umbrella term for the opportunity space issues or just the topic you are brought there to do. I like this approach in product that you should focus more on the problem than on the solution. So that's why I call them problems. So the main quest is what you're here for, the main problem you're solving. Be sure that you agree also with your champion that this is what they see. And also if that their boss sees it the same way, because sometimes there's a lot of misalignment. At the more organized clients, this same main quest maintains throughout. But I've had clients where we talk about me coming in to help on a topic. On the first day, the topic changes completely. On the third day, it again changes and so on. And that is also fine as long as you agree with them, give them a heads up, okay, new thing, new onboarding on the topic, or this was going to take a little bit more. And at the same time, to try to also contain them to not change scope too many times, because then you won't be able to make an impact if you jump around too much. And the side quests, I see them as nice benefits, but it's helpful to look at this only if you secure the main one, if this is a decent in some way, if it helps your stakeholders or peers, or just gets the troublemaker a bit more silent. And ideally, if it furthers a client's mission or long-term goal. So we would go back to the strategic product context that you need as a PM when onboarding. And for the product context, I didn't have any gospel to say, because this is so varied. So what I try to frame this as more for yourself, if you're, of course, these slides are also publicly accessible, so you can peruse them later, more like a set of questions on how to look at this company and then make your own mind about what's their product context. As it was incredibly hard to summarize what that is. And it also, in some cases, we are not engaged to help the full company, but just a certain division that does a certain narrow scope for a bunch of personas. So then the product context of the whole company matters more like a nice to know thing, but more in to make sure we don't do something that conflicts with it or that won't help. But then we're more interested into the context of the specific area we're tackling. So that would be a bit based on the jobs to be done approach. So what's the most important job the company or the division you're helping exists to solve? What evidence do we have that we've clearly understood the customer jobs? Sometimes the clients don't understand it themselves, so you need to do a bit more work there. What are the experience of purchase and use that their customers currently have? For this, I've done a lot of mapping the flow, especially of the first user experience. And I was surprised of how many clients don't even have that or didn't have an overview internally on it. That second line of questions, when they choose something else, so when by they I mean here the customers of your client, so whatever their end users are, why do they do it instead? So this helps you understand the competitive space, but not only in the direct competitors, also indirect competitors. So for example, going back to our McDonald's, you can say that Burger King is a direct competitor. But also the intermittent fasting, diet fads, and something like Weight Watchers would be an indirect competitor, because if you're on a diet, you're probably not eating at McDonald's. So that is a more holistic way to look at the market. So if the market for people eating healthier grows, then it means the market for quick service restaurants that are not on the healthy side is going to shrink. So who is not consuming the products, the company's products today? How do their jobs differ from the current customers? In which circumstances are these customers trying to make progress? So again, the jobs to be done, is a bit different from how you look at personas or pain points, because they focus a lot on the context. So if it's raining outside and you're in a hurry, it doesn't matter that you are a millennial or an office worker or something else, you are more likely to take a taxi. So then the persona doesn't matter as much as the circumstance that's forcing you to get a job done. And then all these jobs have functional, emotional, and social dimensions. The emotional and social dimensions are very strong in products, for example, like Instagram, whereas the functional ones are stronger in the B2B sector, because you hire them more a tool to get this job done. But when in doubt, focus first on the functional. And then the same part, but for the company. So here I structured it between process and culture, although it's a pretty hard thing to differentiate. Sometimes it's a bit intertwined. And there, what I noticed, it's helpful to understand what is set in stone and what is negotiable. What processes do you need to follow super enthusiastically and never comment on? And what kind of things you can say, I'll just do my thing and not let this get in the way. And I've encountered a big flavor of this. So people who are super methodology cultists with all the small bullet point acceptance criteria in tickets, but didn't really care that something was breaking in production because, hey, the bullet points were there. And others who are just do whatever you want. We have this OKR and this target to hit. We don't care how you do it. And then the how does your champion stakeholders and peers share info and updates? So this I just try to mirror whatever is happening at the company if it's not extremely dysfunctional. So if are they doing a lot more Slack updates in some channels, I do more Slack. If they're doing more email, I do more email. How do people get their things done? Is it more informal? Is it formal? Do you need some advanced planning? What kind of ticketing system each department uses and what methods? And this varies all across the board. And then where's the useful info stored? Most companies have this combination of some Confluence and then some stuff in a Microsoft SharePoint or a Google Drive. And this you don't get access to unless you figure out to which type of drive or SharePoint you should get invited to and who should give you what kind of information. And this is a bit harder to track down. Oopsie. On the culture, this was easier in an office to figure out the vibe. The rest you can mostly sense from what the communication like that is happening in some places and how do people act and react when their boss is not around or when their boss is involved, how are things escalated, and what are the no-go areas or some things that went horribly wrong in the past and they just like don't want to discuss that topic anymore if they've been burned on a certain methodology or a certain approach. It's just better to stay away from that. And then to end on something more grounding, and also another thing that I like a lot is from Rick and Morty, is that not all our clients want these life-changing outcomes. And some just have some menial, boring things that they need someone to get done. But when you talk to them, the expectation is that it's something super big. So I'm going to load another video. And this was not a video.
What is my purpose?
Pass the butter. Thank you.
Dad, I need a ride to work.
Maybe Rick can give you a ride. I'm helping Morty with science.
I'm busy.
Doing what?
Anything else?
What is my purpose?
You pass butter.
Oh my God.
Yeah, welcome to the club, pal.
All right, so that's the end of my presentation.
Thank you very much. That was really... Yes, indeed. if any one of the participants have any questions, just feel free to type them in the chat or even use the QA section. It should be below your screens. We'll just have a few more minutes for that, so feel free. I think they're still processing everything.
Well, for Rick and Morty videos, there's also one that fits gathering the right requirements. You can Google it. It's you'll find it on YouTube under Keep Summer Safe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Rick and Morty has a lot of things that you can repurpose for finding examples.
Absolutely. So there it is. You have a question.
Oh, this is a bit flaky when I try to open it and I'm in share.
I can read it for you, no worries. So,
go ahead.
Okay. So, one of the first questions is, as a new PM, how do you justify funding for innovation projects?
Usually I don't. So if I'm brought in on an innovation project, it's because someone else has already justified the funding for it. So usually consultants are the result of some people figuring out they need some sort of thing, and then figuring out they either try to do it internally or they don't, or they decide from the beginning that they don't want to scale this team up internally, and they get external people, or it just fails and then they get external people. So I've been brought on innovation projects more in 2019, this year not at all, but it's of course with Corona, the whole innovation stuff was cut, but I wouldn't justify it. But one client, we are researching for them to either build an MVP or invest in an existing startup, or just do some sort of partnership with them, or build a separate venture. And there we're making the classical market research, problem sizing, competitor analysis, and so on. But I would say that the classic answer is in these cases, you're mostly brought in after some people have justified that funding, and that's why you exist there. Thank you, Gaurav, for the question. What about getting a job in another country and culture? So from I did that. So my first PM job was working for a Bay Area company where the CEO was Belgian, living in the Bay Area. My boss and the CTO and co-founder was also so we had a mix of management in between Bay Area and Brussels, and I was sitting with a tech team in Bucharest. So that was one of the cultures. Before that, I worked at Avira, which is a German antivirus company, but working for them out of Romania. Then I worked for a company based in Dubai, and we were remote back in 2013. And then I moved to Germany. It depends, but it's kind of this mix where the local culture influences in some way the company culture, but then there are also these company culture stereotypes that just get blended in. It's in between communication style and also the size and maturity of the company that you can mostly look at. What I would say the difference between the American and the German culture that would be the most visible is that the German culture seems a bit rude and mean, but they're generally more helpful, whereas the American culture is initially very friendly, but you would get also fired very fast without getting too much feedback. So it kind of has a low tolerance for mistakes, even if it looks a lot more approachable. The German culture has some tolerance for mistakes, but they will like take your eyes out for it. In a nutshell. And I've also worked a bit with the Korean culture, which has a lot of these space saving things. So they never give you direct or let's say, what you'd consider in Europe constructive feedback. They generally agree with you. And if they actually agree with you, then they will follow up. And if they don't, they just disappear and you don't hear from them. And then you figure out that this wasn't what they wanted. So thank you, anonymous attendee. Aurora, nice seeing you here. What is the name of the book that you would recommend to read? You mentioned it earlier. You mean the one about the culture series? It's called The Player of Games. It's also on Audible, and the voice of the reader is quite nice. And then he reads also the whole series. I would recommend not starting with the first one in the series, because even the author himself said, yeah, he kind of had that around and had to finish it at some point. But it's not as good. So if you want to start the series, start with The Player of Games. And the one where I got the quote from is from the one you could read afterwards called The Use of Weapons. And then Anonymous, can you go through an example scenario on how to deal with troublemakers? Oh, there's so many. How do you start? Where to start? So there are also some clips you could watch that are nice. I enjoy a lot Taylor from Billions, because it's this character that is in the finance bro scene and is someone who doesn't have a gender that they identify with and so on. So it's like very different from what traditionally is in the financial sector, but does very well at standing up to people and also getting her point across. And there's this poker scene that I also show to my team where she's playing poker with a politician, and the politician says, oh, come on, cupcakes, you know, this is not a place for the weak, and so on. And then she kind of thinks, and everyone thinks she's going to fold, and says, you don't have the cards. You're on a gut move, and you're a bully, and bullies don't like when they're confronted. And then just completely disarms the guy. So it's very hard to give like a general example. Like, first of all, to kind of try to find them, and then figure out what their incentives are, because most people are not just like evil and following you around to annoy you. They're either from some competitive department, or there's some sort of misalignment, but also some are just attention seekers. So it's, and some are just difficult personalities. So anything goes. There's also this book, Never Split the Difference, that kind of has a few negotiation techniques. And there's also a funny way to manage stakeholders. So I kind of think about that sometimes in meetings where I kind of need to nod through and like have them end on still on some sort of agreement. It's from this movie called The Big Short, where one of these private equity firms makes some investments before the financial crisis, which their mothership thinks it's imprudent and sends the risk assessors there. And you need to Google that, because he says some very impolite things. But it says like, go in there very calmly and very politely and tell the risk assessors this. So this is what I always remember when dealing with stakeholders, like very calmly, very politely. And then you won't say what the guy said there, but it still works. All right, another one from Gaurav. How do you handle projects where you don't have domain expertise or geographical knowledge? I try to get it. So there's always someone, for example, at Omio, where I had no domain expertise aside from me just trying to book cheap flights for a while. There was someone there with, I think, over 10 years of experience. And there were also a few onboarding materials. So it was just talking to the person and asking a lot of naive questions. And this part of falling asleep to a bunch of Wikipedia articles that my phone read to me on just some topics. And it's also it's an industry full of acronyms. So we need to learn all these acronyms, because people don't talk in real words. They talk only in this set of acronyms that you need to first understand what they mean to get half of the conversation. And for the geographical knowledge, That I would say it depends. If the product is already operating in the market, then they would know. There would be either sales or operations over there that knows about it. And it also depends what is it about. Is it payment methods? Because that is something that I can make research on. And when I was leading product at Watchmaster, which is a managed marketplace for luxury watches, which is in a few markets in Europe, we just looked, okay, what do people pay with in the UK and in the Netherlands? And we've noticed from Germany that people like to buy their Rolex via financing, because then you end up paying 50 euros for 5 years or something like that, that is more manageable. So what kind of financing providers are out there that are reliable, and then what's the commission they're taking, and what's the process of integrating them? So that's the question. It kind of depends what do you use the geographical knowledge for. All right, so Bertrand, nice to see you here too. Allocating very long onboarding periods, actually trying to mask having a bad PM culture, or they have no idea what the PM was supposed to be doing. Do you think that a healthy onboarding time can be a good culture indicator also for employees? Yeah, absolutely, because it costs them money. Like we've also had some things at the client where there was this new hire, and one of my team members says, hey, this person keeps asking me for tasks. And I'm like, this is, they've come to the right place. Because that person has joined the company, they saw like a presentation of here's our vision and our blah, blah, but they're like, no one gave her anything to do or mentored or gave her feedback on her work, you know, like these things that you would appreciate having, especially in your first days. And there we were handing over as consultants some responsibilities, and then we just took over a bit for the person. And if the person wanted things to do, why not help her out? So yeah, this I've seen quite a lot. And also people somehow separating the onboarding process from real work, whereas my preference would be that you read a few things, you set up your accounts, and then you tackle something, because otherwise you are just getting this passive experience of socializing lunches and some other stuff without you creating value or without actually getting what the work is about. Is there something else, Bertrand, that I should say? Cool. Alvaro Viegas, how do you suggest to get stakeholder to align on complex? Wait, these things moved. How do you say, so we answered Bertrand's questions. We can move to Alvaro. How do you suggest to get stakeholders to align on complex topics like defining common KPIs? You define them. You agree with, so if it's already like the question starts, like the stakeholders don't really know what they want. And my preference whenever this happens is like, if a lot of people have opinions, then I also have mine, and I would have a preference for mine. If someone doesn't have better data or something to support their opinions. I think this I learned from one of our former speakers, that she had kind of a good way of getting people to talk about data and facts again. So I would take a step back. It's like, what is the company trying to achieve this year or this quarter? If you're venture funded, are you investors looking at some KPIs? Because then this would be your KPIs, or at least it would be the North Star or the bigger KPIs out of which you define yours. Or has the management, CEO, is there, I think this is already there. Maybe talk with your founder or CEO or whatever management, what are the things that they're floating around in their meetings, because that would be the first place to look at. And then the second, they say, okay, yeah, but these are the high level for the company and what are actually mine. Then you can use something like the KPI driver trees to see how you influence these North Star KPIs or the core KPIs of the company through the other things you work on that don't directly affect these KPIs, but affect some KPIs that feed into it. Does this make sense to you, Alvaro? Okay, the question disappeared. All right, bye, Gaurav. So we have Anonymous. Do you aim to extend your consulting engagement? If yes, how? For some, they are set up that they will end. So for example, when we hold an interim position until the new PM is hired and onboarding, so then depending on how big the organization is, we may jump onto something or we may end the engagement and come up some other time. As a consultant, of course, my answer to this is yes. But in some cases, it doesn't make sense. And then we also talk usually like a month before the engagement ends. We talk with our champion there. It's like, what are the plans for budget and so on? Because if we're extending, then we need to plan the next thing. And if it's if the engagement is ending, then we need to plan the offboarding, so the handover with the person who's taking over, having that person do some shadowing, then getting that person to be the front runner for a while, updating some documentation if we need to, and anything else that we need to wrap up. But yeah, of course, we try to extend our engagements. So this is done. I think this is all the questions. I see there are also...
Yes, we have a few more in the chat, actually.
Okay, then I'll pop up the chat. Okay. Hey, nice to see you here, Sasha, as well. Like a lot of people that I know from various places. I found the short one-day internships with all relevant business functions extremely useful for both understanding context and building connections and influence. That is pretty cool. I'd be curious to learn more about that because I haven't seen it in the companies we've been at before. The question from Alvaro, we've already answered because he also posted it in the Q&A. Andrea Krochun, how do you deal with generation gaps coming in as a young consultant in a team of people with an older mentality? I kind of try to show that I'm not as young as I look, and not so I've had that from call from someone from Asia. That was one of the comments, and I like how the person handled herself. We were in an in a corporate call where, you know, like gray hair people on the other hand, and then and there was a sort of comment like that, and she said, you know, I'm not as young as I look, I'm a lot older and a lot more experienced, or something like that. And then kind of everyone chuckled and moved away from disillusions that the person is not qualified enough. And I also try most of the time to introduce myself to the work that I've done or the credentials that we have, especially in Germany. They like when people have an MBA or an engineering degree and all of this stuff, because Germany appreciates diplomas for some reason. And the other part through the work. So I didn't feel like I get dismissed as much. I've had more trouble with being, let's say, female in tech while I was employed. As a consultant, I found it less hard to have these problems. Maybe because as an external, I don't need to be approved by the peer group, because as you come in with already the differentiation and they know that you're not there to stay and you're helping interim and you're also an expensive resource. So I've had people spend less time trying to argue on biases with me, but I still get it sometimes, and I have various methods of diffusing it, because, and in any case, if they do it, it's kind of costing them because they're slowing me down and I'm not able to help them. Does this help you, Andrea? Is Andrea still in the call?
I see her still as an attendee, so.
Oh, okay. Oh, cool.
Yep. There she is. Great. So that was a lot of questions. That's good. Any other person having any comment, question, feedback? I think we did.
Oh, by the way, cool plants in your background.
Oh, thanks. So, yeah, I guess if we don't have any other questions or comments, I would say thank you very much, Mirela. That was an amazing talk, great tips, great experience, really amazed. Thank you very much. I think everyone just enjoyed it as well based on the comments, the questions. So happy to have you part of this webinar series, and we really look forward to further collaboration. And thank you everyone who attended. I wish you all a very great day and a nice week ahead of you.
Same here, and thanks Manjit and Noemi for your nice comments.
Great, thank you everyone.
Thanks, bye.
Bye.